Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. So I'm going to give a short talk on foot and ankle injuries. So basic physical examination is the same for every joint, like inspection, palpation, range of motion, and you need to check the strength and assess the neuromuscular. So an inspection of the foot and ankle, you have to look for the swelling, any ecchymosis, which is really ecchymosis mean a blood underneath the skin and subcutaneous tissue, or any obvious deformity. And after the inspection, you should go for palpation before you check for the range of motion and palpation. In the foot and ankles, ankle is you have a medial and lateral malleolus. You have to palpate to look for a tenderness. And localized temperature and base of the fifth metatarsal, and you palpate the Achilles tendon, which is behind the largest tendon in the body, and then you see your midfoot and then the proximal fibula as well, right? Okay. And the range of motion, I mean, just remember two movements in the ankle joint, which is the dorsiflexion and plantar flexion, and the other is inversion and inversion. Inversion is basically not at the ankle joint, it's at the subtalar level between the talus and the calcaneum. And then you must assess the neurovascular status of the foot below the ankle. The normal ankle range of motion is, if you see, I mean, this is 90 degree, I mean, this is the leg, this is the foot. So it's from this neutral position of 90 degree, the dorsiflexion is 20 degree and plantar flexion is more, which is around 40 degree. Ankle range of motion, and this the inversion is 20 degree, which when you move your foot inward towards your body, and outward, which is eversion, actually takes place, as I told you earlier, in the subtalar level. Bones of the ankle joint, I mean, ankle joint is formed by three bones. Tibia onto the medial side, fibula onto the lateral side. So the lower end of the fibula is called the lateral malleolus, and which takes part in the formation of ankle joint. And the tibia is the distal end of the tibia, and on the medial side, the medial malleolus, and the articular surface of the talus. So these three bones take part in the formation of ankle joint. And as for the foot is concerned, there are so many bones. I don't know, you know, we have the calcaneum, which is the largest bone in the foot. And then you have the talus on top of the calcaneum. And then you have the navicular bone. And then you have these are the metatarsal five. And these five metatarsal articulate with first, second, and third metatarsal articulate with medial, lateral, and medial, intermediate, and lateral cuneiforms. And the last, fourth, and fifth metatarsal articulates with the cuboid bone. All right, okay. Ligaments, again, there are so many ligaments, but for important ligaments in the ankle joints is this anterior talofibular ligament, which really go, this is a you can remember lateral ligament complex, which is on the lateral side of the ankle. So it has this anterior talofibular ligament anteriorly and posteriorly posterior talofibular ligament, and this one is the on the lateral side exactly is calcaneofibular ligament, which really attach from the lower end of the fibula to the calcaneum. So the lateral ligament complex comprises three ligaments, anterior and posterior talofibular, and the calcaneofibular ligament. And then there are other ligaments which connects among these metatarsal bones and metatarsal. So the special test for the integrity of the anterior talofibular ligament is the anterior draught test. You hold with one hand the distal end of the fibula, and with the other hand hold the heel of the patient and try to move forward, okay, in a neutral position, and you compare it with the other side, and you feel the difference between this laxity. And whenever we have it, this is just the clinical diagnosis of the tear in the anterior talofibular ligament or sprain of the anterior talofibular ligament. Other this that actually this test the integrity of the anterior talofibular ligament as well as the calcaneofibular ligament. So what you do is just put your hand onto the medial side of this distal tibia, and you invert the foot forcibly. Okay, and then you compare it with the other side, and you see the laxity, and you compare the laxity with the other side. Okay. I don't know whether you really should know this Ottawa rules, when to image a suspected injury of the ankle and foot. And so if you want to remember that, 98% sensitivity for fracture, decreased radiographs, do not apply rule if pregnancy, multiple pain injuries, compromised sensation. So this is the Ottawa rule, is that a series of ankle x-ray film is required only if there is any pain in malleolar zone and any of these findings. Okay, bone tenderness at A is your little malleolus. You just elicit tenderness behind the little malleolus. If it is tender, you should go for x-ray. Okay, and bone tenderness at B, and B is your this posterior edge of the tip of the medial malleolus. Okay, a series of foot x-rays, these are for ankle. Okay, tenderness behind the little malleolus and tenderness behind the medial malleolus. Go for x-ray. The same for the ankle, is the inability to be awake both immediately and emergency department. You should go for x-ray of the ankle and the foot. Oh, I took the case one. So she's a 35 years old woman, sustained an ankle inversion injury. So what is inversion? Anyone can speak? Can anyone tell what is inversion?
When the ankle goes medially.
Medial, okay. Basically, it takes place at the level of the subtalar joint, but involve the ankle as well. Okay, 35 years old woman sustained an ankle inversion injury while playing soccer, able to bear weight after the injury, and currently pain is localized to the lateral ankle. Okay, so when you invert your ankle, the structures which stretch around the ankle are on the lateral side. They are under stretch or stress, you can say. Okay, on examination there was no bony tenderness. Why the bony tenderness is important? What is the significance of bony tenderness? Localized bony tenderness,
fracture.
Yeah, sometimes if there is a minor crack in the bone, maybe the x-ray is normal. Okay, patient is complaining of pain. So the definitive clinical signs for the fracture is localized bony tenderness. Sometimes you don't see the fracture on the ankle or anywhere, but the localized bony tenderness is important as far as the clinical diagnosis of the fracture is concerned. So no bony, localized bony tenderness. Significant swelling of lateral ankle. So there is significant swelling around the lateral malleolus. Good end point on anterior drawer and talar tilt test. The examiner did the anterior drawer, just to, as I said, in the lateral view, you hold the your distal tibia and try to pull your foot forward. So, and did the talar tilt set, which is inversion test. So good end point on anterior drawer and talar. Did you understand this good endpoint? What that means?
Normal. Normal in comparison with the other foot.
And neuromuscular intact. End point. Good end point.
Normally.
So, a good end point. I mean, when you stress the ligament, suppose you test for this latissimus ligament, you forcibly invert the foot and there's the end point. You can't keep on going on inversion. You try to invert and there's a stop on that. So that is the end point. So there's a stop in the end. So what that signifies? Do you understand the type of supreme? How many you can apply this classification to all the ligaments of the joints in the body? How many types? Type 1, type 2, and type 3 supreme. You use the term supreme for the ligaments and for the muscles. Which term you use for the muscles?
Fracture.
No, for the muscles, what you use?
Tear.
Yes, tear, but you use the term strain, S-T-R-A-I-N. So the ligaments, they strain, muscles, they strain. Okay, so the diagnosis on this particular lady was made of a anterior tibiofibular ligament strain.
Why, okay. Doctor? The test is normal.
Test is normal. As I said, the sprain is three types, type 1, type 2, type 3. Type 1 is the simple bruising of the ligament. Okay, no break in the continuity of the ligament. That is a type 1 sprain. Type 2 sprain is when there is a partial tear of the ligament. Some fibers are torn and majority of the fibers intact. And type 3 sprain is when all the fibers of the ligaments torn completely. Is a type 3 sprain. Okay, so that is why I say end point. In type 1 and type 2, there is an end point. But in type 3, you keep on moving the foot in inversion and it keeps on going. Right, okay. So the most common ligament which sprain in the ankle is your this anterior talofibular. This is fibula, this is tibia, this is anterior talofibular ligament, and this is calcaneofibular. So it's usually either isolated or in combination with calcaneofibular. So this is the most common ligament which sprain in the ankle. And inversion injury is the most common injury as far as the sprain of the ankle is concerned. Just remember this thing, okay? So this talofibular is from the talus up to the tip of the fibula, and the calcaneofibular is tip of the fibula up to the calcaneo. It's on the little side. So West Point sprain grading system, which I told you earlier, the grade 1 is the microscopic, simple bruised, swelling is minimal, joint instability none, weight bearing partial, and grade 2 partial. As I said, some fibers are intact, some fibers are, and there is a moderate swelling. And instability is mild to moderate, and weight bearing unable. Okay, grade 3 complete rupture, severe swelling, moderate to severe joint instability, unable to put weight. Okay, staging initially established for different treatment plans, but now regardless of staging, all complete the same treatment plan, functional rehabilitation. So management of ankle sprain, second neuromuscular ankle training, increased strength, improved proprioception, balance exercises, this is all the physiotherapy job. Air cast sprint initially, additional lateral stability, boot only if think more severe diagnosis on differential. Right, okay, so initially depending on the type of sprain, type 1, don't go so aggressive as far as the immobilization and splintage is concerned. Type 2, a little bit more. And if it's type 3, you even can go for the plaster as well. Crutches for pain, weight bearing as tolerated with heel to toe walking, whether this is type 1, type 2, or type 3. And the rice, remember this thing, rest, ice, compression bandage, and elevation. just remember this thing. You can apply this mode of treatment to every ligament sprain. So emphasize early range of motion exercises. So this is a nice sprain. I really like this sprain. This is called the air cast sprain for the ankle. Okay. And this is another sort of a sprain. This is not an air cast sprain. You can actually blow air inside. There's a fiberglass, this one. And inside there's a soft, which you can put air in. And this is the normal ankle sprain. So the sprained ankle, and you keep this sprained for 6 weeks minimum. Okay, depending on the type 3, you keep it for a longer time. Okay, and if the patient after 6 weeks still complaining of pain, and I tell you that while walking I feel that my ankle is unstable, so then you need to confirm, okay, whether this is a radiologically to confirm, okay, whether this is complete tear like type 3 or type 1 or type 2. Okay, and in that case the options available are either you do a stress view, the one which I showed, inversion view, which you clinically judge, but you take x-ray of the ankle and you see whether there's any tilt and compare it with the other side, or you can do the MRI scan just to confirm. If the patient keep on complaining of instability while walking on a normal surface, I feel that my ankle is not stable after intensive physiotherapy and need a surgical intervention. So case 2, 23 years old male with anterior ankle pain. Okay, the previous case was a lateral ankle pain. Anterior ankle pain, was playing football a day before and was pushed back by another player while his foot able to bear weight. Pushed back by another player with his foot, not while his foot. Able to bear weight since injury, but with pain. So on examination, minimal ankle swelling. Okay, pain with bearing weight. Difficulty rising on toes, was unable to stand on tiptoes. Limited dorsiflexion, secondary to pain. Positive squeeze test and neurovascular intact. Any diagnosis come to your mind? Anyway, this is the case. Diagnosis, the syndesmotic injury was made. So syndesmotic is you can call it a high ankle sprain of ligaments between tibia and fibula. All right, okay. So this is the fibula and this is the tibia. So this and this interosseous membrane between these two, tibia and the fibula. This is the side view. Okay, and the ligaments involved is the posterior inferior tibiofibular ligament, which is behind, and anterior inferior tibiofibular ligament. This is the AP view, front view. This is your tibia. This is your fibula. So this ligaments connect these two bones together. This anterior inferior tibiofibular ligament. And the same thing on the behind is the posterior inferior tibiofibular ligament, and then this interosseous membrane which connects. So this is this complex make a syndesmosis between the tibia and fibula. So associated with rotational injury, pushed back on a planted foot. Okay. Squeeze test is compression of the mid tibia and fibula with reproduction of pain in the ankle. So this is your syndesmotic, this area, and then you compress the tibia and fibula with your hand and patient feels pain over here. So this is called high ankle sprain. Physical examination, pain with external rotation test. So you just simply hold the distal tibia with your one hand and you externally rotate, not eversion, rather externally rotate the foot, and patient feel pain. Tenderness between the tibia and fibula. Okay, positive squeeze test, which I explained earlier, and his dorsiflexion is limited. Pain with weight bearing and rising up on their toes, on tiptoes, patient feels pain. Imaging x-ray, main axis, possible widening of the space between tibia and fibula. Just remember this. You don't need to remember the exact figure. Treatment of high ankle sprain, syndesmotic injury, again the plaster or boot of functional rehabilitation, strengthening early range of motion similar to ankle sprain. And it takes twice as long to recover as compared to ankle sprains. So this injury takes longer time to heal. Widening with fracture may require a surgical repair. Sometimes these syndesmotic injury associated with a fracture of the tibia or fibula, then it needs a fixation of the fracture. So do not miss in these ankle injuries mesonerve fracture. This is a proximal fibula fracture that occurs with avulsion fracture of the medial malleolus or rupture of the deltoid ligament. Deltoid ligament is onto the medial side. So ankle joint has got two ligaments, lateral ligament complex and medial ligament complex. Medial ligament complex is called the deltoid ligament. So this is the proximal fibula fracture in this case, in which there was a rupture of the deltoid ligament along with a proximal fibula fracture. So this is called a Meissonet fracture. So case 3, 65 years old woman who sustained an inversion injury of her ankle while stepping off a curb yesterday. So same sort of injury which was for the lateral this ligament complex sprain. So inversion injury. So while stepping off a curb yesterday, localized pain to foot and lateral ankle. Unable to bear weight at the time of the injury, but can now. Significant swelling of the lateral ankle, tenderness over the base of the fifth metatarsal bone. Neurovascular intact. So swelling around the lateral side of the ankle, but localized bony tenderness over the base of the fifth metatarsal. So what is the diagnosis?
Same as the first one, anterior tibial fibula.
Say it again.
Anterior fibula ligament tear.
So why it's tender over the base of the fifth metatarsal?
But the same mechanism of injury.
Last one.
Huh? But your mechanism, you combine your mechanism with your clinical examination, isn't it? Here the tenderness onto the base of the fifth metatarsal.
Why maybe the lateral.
Why don't you think of the fracture of the base of the fifth metatarsal?
Along with the ligament.
Say it again?
Along with, because there is a swelling in the lateral ankle.
Yeah, maybe. Yes, you're right, maybe. Anyway, so this is the thing. Fifth metatarsal fracture. So on the lateral side, this is the fifth metatarsal. So this is the tuberosity of the fifth metatarsal. Okay. And this is the cuboid bone. The fourth and fifth metatarsal, they articulate with the cuboid bone. So this is your, which muscle insert on the base of the fifth metatarsal?
We don't remember anything on
that. Yeah, peroneus brevis. The two muscles which run behind the lateral malleolus. These are peronei. Peroneus brevis. Right, okay. And the other is peroneus longus, which goes to the base of the first metatarsal. So fifth metatarsal, you have these fractures, avulsion fracture. This is pull up because of the pull of the peroneus brevis muscle, tendon onto this. And this is a Jones fracture and this is stress fracture. So at three level, remember these types, avulsion fracture due to pull, Jones fracture, and then stress fracture over here. So avulsion fracture, no fracture line present in the space between the fourth and fifth metatarsal. Different from the Jones fracture. Okay, the fracture lines over here, not between the fifth and the fourth metatarsal. So the one fracture line is in between these two bones, fourth and this one. So treatments, weight bearing as tolerated, hard sole shoe. Normally we give plaster for 6 to 8 weeks. and rarely surgical repair for this fracture. The Jones fracture, the don't miss fracture, see in sprinters and jumpers and dancer as well. Do you know who was Jones? Why it's called Jones fracture?
I don't know that.
Jones was an orthopedic surgeon. While he was dancing, he got this fracture. So he was.
He's dancing?
Yeah, he was dancing. He got the fracture. This is inversion injury. While dancing, you can. If you are drunk, especially. He's Irish surgeon. Irish orthopedic surgeon. So while he was dancing, maybe drunk, so got an inversion injury to the foot. Yeah. So and he got this fracture. So he put this fracture on his name, John's fracture. I thought the treatment is, it is plaster. Normally we give a plaster for these, non-weight bearing with cast for 6 to 8 weeks, followed by 4 to 6 weeks in walking boot. Okay. The only thing is that, this fracture, Jones, because there's a chance of delayed union, non-union is there. So we put in a plaster 4 to 6 weeks, non-weight bearing, and then another cast for 4 to 6 weeks with a weight bearing. Basically, if athlete surgery is required, 30% to 50% will refracture. Right, okay. So if the fracture doesn't unite or in athlete, but most of the time we get away with this management without any, non-union. But sometimes these fractures, especially these Jones fracture, it tends to go into a non-union. So even if it's non-union, it's usually a painless non-union. It doesn't cause much pain. So it can be left in a older people without any fixation or without any further treatment if it goes into a non-union. So this is a Jones fracture is over here. Avulsion fracture is over here. So this is on basically the junction of the metaphysis and the diaphysis. So it's tendency to delayed union and non-union is there. So that is why when we put the plaster, we keep them non-weight bearing. Case 4. 27 years old male player presents after an ankle injury occurred yesterday when he fell forward on his foot. Seen in an urgent care yesterday with normal ankle x-rays, discharged with walking boot and crutches. And came to the clinic, significant swelling and ecchymosis of the midfoot. So midfoot comprises which bones?
Talus. Talus bone.
Cuneiform.
Yeah, you can say the head of the talus. Yeah, but basically it's your navicular bone and these cuneiform and the cuboid is that like that. Okay, neuromuscular intact, tenderness over the tarsometatarsal joints. Pain with weight bearing and unable to stand on tiptoes. So this is Lisfranc ligament. Have you heard of Lisfranc injury?
No.
This is first metatarsal, second, third, fourth, and fifth. Right, okay. So this is basically these metatarsal, they are intertarsal ligaments. And so this basically Lisfranc ligament, important ligament, this is the medial cuneiform. Medial cuneiform articulated with the first metatarsal, intermediate cuneiform with the second, and the third is a lateral cuneiform with a third metatarsal. These last fourth and fifth articulate with the which bone?
Not
cuboid.
Cuboid, yes, good. So 4, 5 with cuboid. So 1, 2, 3 cuneiform with the first three metatarsal, and this is your navicular bone. Okay. So this ligament goes from the base of this second metatarsal to the medial cuneiform. So this is the important connection between the first and second. Okay, so injury causes separation of the base of the first and second metatarsal, leading to forefoot instability. So this is called a Lisfranc injury. So any injury which involves these metatarsal joint is called the Lisfranc injury. Referred to as a Lisfranc if there is a any disruption of the tarsometatarsal joint complex, as I told you. Okay, it can be simple ligament sprain, or it can be associated with a fracture. Injury can range from sprain of the Lisfranc ligaments to a dislocation due to ligament tear or fracture. So they say, why is this area of the foot prone to injury? Transfer ligaments connect the bases of the four lateral metatarsal. No transfer ligament exists between the first and second metatarsal base. Minimal sports increase risk of injury. Always go for a weight-bearing X-ray. This is the injury and the X-ray. This is without what you call without putting weight, and this X-ray was taken weight-bearing. And now you can see increased space between the, this is the medial cuneiform and the second metatarsal.
So, doctor, the ligament attached from medial cuneiform to the second metatarsal?
Yeah, from like base of the, this is the second metatarsal, here to here, here to here. Oh, yes. It's cut in there, so that's why a non-weight bearing looks okay. Okay. And when you see, a non, this normally the second metatarsal, the medial, this medial side trigger, this goes in line with the middle cuneiform or intermediate cuneiform. This is a lateral cuneiform. It's in line. Here, this line is disrupted. This the space is increased and line is disrupted. Now, is not, can you see, appreciate that? Second metatarsal coming in line with the intermediate cuneiform. But here, this is disrupted. This is not a in line. There's a break, step over there. Lisfranc NG X-ray evaluation, look for widening of space between first and second. Look for fracture at base of second metatarsal. Not necessary, it's always there. X-ray finding very subtle. If have midfoot pain and negative XR, still possibility of Lisfranc and need follow-up. Weight-bearing view, widening more than 2 mm between first and second metatarsal bases indicate at least ligamentous injury present. Okay, this is as previous, but this is non-weight bearing, and this is weight bearing, increased space with the weight bearing. Flag sign, avulsion of base of second metatarsal represent rupture of the Lisfranc ligament. If you see this flag of bone, so basically the ligament, this Lisfranc ligament rupture from the base of the second metatarsal, and you can the flag sign.
Not always present.
Not always. So, I mean, it depends if it pulls with a bone or if it pulls without bone. Lisfranc treatment, clinical diagnosis, 20-30% missed initially. Okay. Midfoot pain, tarsometatarsal pain, plus injury, plus pain with weight bearing, think of Lisfranc and get a weight bearing X-ray. Treatment, again, boot or splint and make non-weight bearing cast. This is treatment usually almost always surgical. I mean, it depends really. I mean, if a simple sprain or ligaments without, separation, you can get away with it. But if there's associated with fracture or dislocation, then you have to reduce the this dislocation or subluxation, and you have to use a K-wire to hold it in position. So if the first metatarsal dislocates or subluxates, you reduce it to the medial cuneiform and put a wire. If it's a second, again, you reduce it and use a wire. And sometimes if it's a very extensive injuries, I don't want to go into details of that. Sometimes you have to fuse these joints as well. So, case 5. So it's 42 years old woman present with persistent heel pain for the last several months. No injury to the area. Pain is worse in the morning and improves throughout the day. Increased pain with activity. On examination, tenderness at the base of the calcaneum onto the medial side. Neurovascular intact, no swelling or ecchymosis. So what is the diagnosis?
Calcaneus fracture.
For the last several months, huh?
She maybe lived- minor.
He is living with a fracture for the last several months. Eh? No injury to the area. So happened this. So you have to, history is important, I mean the diagnosis, and then your clinical
examination. So history
didn't see any fracture. It says pain is worse in the morning when she wakes up and improves throughout the day if there's a fracture.
Joint pain, joint problem.
Increased pain with activity, tenderness at the base of the calcaneum. Neurovascular intact. Have you heard of plantar fasciitis?
No.
Plantar fasciitis, it's quite common actually. We see on a regular basis. So you should be familiar with plantar fasciitis. If you dissect the sole of your foot, so you see the plantar aponeurosis. This is the calcaneum. It arises from the, over here, from the calcaneum. Okay. And it's overuse injury of the plantar fascia. And I mean, over here, I just find out it's really quite common in ladies as compared to male. And risk factors, flat foot, high arch, leg length discrepancy. If there's leg length discrepancy, person tends to put more weight onto the leg, which is longer. Tightness of Achilles tendon and intrinsic foot muscles. Obesity, naturally when you're obese, you put more weight on your heel. Sedentary lifestyle, person who's office job, doesn't move a lot. Prolonged standing, walking at work. Excessive running and poor arch sports shoes. So normally you do x-rays, so not necessary to find this spur over there. So it's called a calcaneus spur. Right, okay. And this is your plantar fascia. So the calcaneal spur actually is not the cause of this plantar fasciitis. This is secondary to the this pulling of the plantar fascia onto the calcaneum, which happens in these cases, plantar fasciitis. But the patient, they are more concerned about, there's a bony growth, so remove this. I say, this is not a cause of this. This is secondary to the stretching of the plantar fascia. And I usually always give them the example, how this thing happened. Your plantar fascia, like you just see it over here. Can see this plantar fascia is attached over here to the calcaneum. So by the stretching, by pulling, so just give the example like that. Okay, like example, you have a nail inside the what you call the wall, and there's a rope attached to it. You understand what I'm trying to say? There's a nail in a wall, and there's a rope attached to the nail. If you pull the rope, what will happen?
We will pull the nail.
Huh?
The nail will come out.
Either the nail will come out, or the nail, if it is strong over there, or either the simply the rope will come out, isn't it? So same thing will happen in this plantar fasciitis. Okay, this plantar fascia is attached to the calcaneum here, and it stretch, keep on pulling the bone. So, and it pulls with it gradually with passage of time, it pulls the piece of bone along with that. So that is the mechanism of calcaneal spur, which you see on the x-rays. So it's not the cause of the plantar fasciitis, is due to the result of the plantar fasciitis. You understand this, my point, or no? Yes or no?
Yes, please.
In between. So diagnosis is history and physical examination. The diagnostic point is that you ask the patient when the pain is more worse, and the patient is always say, doctor, when I wake up in the morning, first few steps are very painful. So that is very diagnostic of plantar fasciitis. Or other thing, they can, after a prolonged sitting, I've sit for 3 or 4 hours, when I stand up, I feel pain in my heel. And as the day goes, the pain, instead of increasing, it lessens actually. Right, okay. So the treatment is physiotherapy. They mentioned this thing, that foot strengthening exercise. Pick up pencil or marbles with toes, like that. This is the, you can tell the patient you can do that. And cough and Achilles strengthening, physiotherapy, massage, arch support, and silicone heel pad, just to protect the heel. Advise the patient to lose weight if she is overweight or he is overweight, and good shoes and painkiller, non-steroid anti-inflammatory. And again, there is something is that which I add this line: if patient education is very important in all these cases, whatever you do, you must tell the patient that the natural history of disease, because this takes roughly 18 months to 36 months to settle. Okay. And night splint, okay, why the patient feels pain early in the morning? Because during the night, foot is in a relaxed position, and it causes further contraction of these plantar fascia. So night splint mean idea is to keep the foot in a dorsiflexion, keep this in a lengthened position, your plantar fascia. There are different things which you can try. So the other treatment, they say, okay, if the patient can't get better with physiotherapy, painkiller, so what is the next option? And patient they get for these extracorporeal shockwave therapy, which you use for the kidney stones. This is tried and some useful result. And these days, this one can platelet rich. Have you heard of this platelet rich plasma? You heard of this platelet rich plasma?
No.
No. These are regenerative medicine. These are very new things. It's coming up now. People, they talk about these. Okay, you take the patient blood, spin it, and then you inject into all these muscular tendons, whether this is a frozen shoulder, whether this is a golfer elbow, tennis elbow, or these plantar fascia, you inject it, and good result. Okay, Sergi as a last resort. Okay, local steroid injection. People give local steroid injection at the painful site here, but it should be discouraged. It should not be given. Case 4. 6. 37 years old male present with slow onset of pain in his posterior heel. He is a runner and is currently training for a half marathon. Recently transitioned from a running shoes to a minimalist shoes. You heard of the minimalist shoes or no?
No, what does it mean, doctor?
Thin shoes. Everything is thin. Your sole is thin. Yeah, thin shoes. So that, because he wants to strengthen the muscles in his hind feet. So no swelling or ecchymosis, tenderness over Achilles tendon. Achilles tendon, I told you earlier that this is the strongest tendon in the body. If somebody asks you the strongest tendon in the body, this tendo Achilles. Pain increases the dorsiflexion and neurovascular intact.
This tendon has a reflex, right, doctor?
Say it again.
This tendon has a reflex. Right?
Yeah, ankle, which you check for the S1 nerve, yeah, root, yeah. So what can happen in the Achilles tendinopathy? So diagnosis was Achilles tendinopathy. So tendinopathy is either you get a tendinitis, inflammation of the tendon, and tendon is always surrounded by these tenosynovitis, sheath around the tendon. So this was the overuse injury of the Achilles tendon, thickening and inflammation of the peritendinous tissue. Risk factors: increase activity, change in footwear, flat foot, cough, tightness. Treatment: ice, stretching, orthotics, heel lift. Okay, when you lift your heel, your high heel shoes, little bit high heel shoes, it will relax your tendo Achilles. So tendo Achilles is on the back. Okay, Achilles exercises initially with an extended knee, quick rise, slow drop, repeat with flex knee. Basically, you just tell the physiotherapy that he has got this Achilles tendinopathy, so you just organize physiotherapy. I don't know whether you're going to remember all these things or not. Posterior heel pain, tendo Achilles rupture. So sudden pain in the heel, primarily men between 30 to 40 years old, causes forceful dorsiflexion. Positive Thompson test. I think you should remember the Thompson test. The Thompson test is, okay, you basically ask the patient to on your these what you call
hanging his leg.
Yeah, hang this foot like, and he's in a like a knee chest position. So the foot is hanging at the edge of the couch, and you squeeze the calf. If the tendon, this tendoicles is intact, foot will move backward. It will call plantar flexion. So this is a negative Thompson test.
Shifting the sorry,
So it's different from the squeeze test for the ankle.
No, this is you're doing from the back, on the back calf muscles. This,
on
the calf, you're squeezing the calf. And that one you're squeezing in the front between the tibia and fibula, you're squeezing. So that they, so this is a tendon rupture here. So when you squeeze it, the calf muscles, and the tendon will, this foot will not move. So this is called Thompson positive. So that is really quite, I mean, diagnostic of the tendoacles rupture. Okay, so you can do ultrasound if your ultrasonographer is good, or you do the MRI scan to confirm the diagnosis. The treatment is both options available. You put a plaster or you repair the tendon. Both are equally good, except normally the patient asks, plaster you apply whether you repair the tendon or not repair. Plaster you have to keep it for 8 weeks. But the re-rupture rate is more with a conservative management. Is around 20%. If the patient says, okay, I will go for conservative management, you just must explain to the patient that chances of re-rupture of this tendon maybe after 6 months or 1 year over there is almost 20%. But again, 80% of the people, they get away. And the re-rupture rate after surgical repair is rough around 4%. So some people, I mean, I usually tell the patient, and patient, they make their own decision. Some go for surgery, some go for conservative management. So the treatment is plaster or the surgical repair. Both are equally good apart from the re-rupture rate. So the Thompson test, you remember, this is for the... Any questions in the tendoacles?
NWB, doctor.
Non-weight bearing.
Okay, clear. Thank you.
Yeah. Case 7, 18 years old male present with the left great toe pain that occurred while playing football this morning. Was pushing off when he toe jammed and developed sudden pain. Pain increases with running. Neuromuscular intact, swelling at first toe metatarsophalangeal joint. Tendonitis at plantar aspect of the first metatarsophalangeal joint. Weakness of great toe compared to contralateral big toe, increased pain with hyperextension of the first metatarsophalangeal joint. Think of any diagnosis? Playing football, pushing off, felt sudden pain in the big
flexure,
toe.
Right.
Huh?
Fracture.
Tenderness at the plantar aspect only. And pain increase with hyperextension of the first metatarsal. Yeah, it could be fracture. It's called turf toe. Turf toe. Sprain of the first metatarsophalangeal joint. So basically, this is the ligaments around it or capsule around it. So basically, hyperextension this way caused the rupture of the supporting structure, capsule or the ligament onto the sole side. So diagnosis is basically clinical, tender onto the, on this side, not on the dorsum. X-ray normal. We do the X-ray, as you said, case. If you just, you have to do the X-ray, just rule out fracture. As in, fracture can happen. So treatment is again ice, rest, ice, painkillers, tapping, stiff shoe, orthotics, I mean, just conservative management. Case 8, 40 years old. Female with month of burning pain of foot. Pain radiates into the toes at times. Feels like there is a rock in my shoe, but there's not one. Pain is worse with running and narrow shoes. Plantar tenderness between third and fourth metatarsal head. Neuromuscular intact. Diagnosis, what is thing? What do you think of?
Allah, we didn't know.
Yeah. Okay. So this is motor neuroma. Diagnosis was motor neuroma. You have these nerve. Okay, and they supply, they divide and they supply over here. These nerves there, which are called the digital nerves. So there's impingement, compressive neuropathy of interdigital nerves as they divide at metatarsal heads. So these are metatarsal head at this level when they divide to go to the side of the toes. Okay, there's a compression or irritation. More common in women, 9 into 1, pain radiating into toes. Okay, if suppose there is a irritation and because of irritation there is swelling, so pain radiate. This is the your third to the this way or this way. On both these two, onto the this border and this border. So the medial border of the fourth and the lateral border of the third toe. If the neuroma is here, then over the over these three, radiating pain. Paresthesia in 40%, plantar tenderness at metatarsal joint, most common between third and fourth metatarsal head. Okay, is this third and fourth. If you come across a patient complaining of pain in these two toes, and say this common site for these motor neuroma, it's called motor neuroma. Positive Mulder's sign. It's difficult to remember Mulder's sign. Squeezing the forefoot from lateral to medial while palpating web space and feel click. So this is the thing. You squeeze the forefoot and you put your this finger between the third and fourth. And if you feel a click, so this is called positive Mulder's sign. Suppose if it's between the second and third, you do repeat with all these web spaces. X-ray is normal. So if you really want to do patient treatment, stop wearing high heel. White toe should not be a tight shoes. Non-steroidal, steroid injection, surgical excision if chronic and not improved with conservative treatment. Before we do the surgical excision, we just want to confirm. So we normally do the MRI scan and we just see this swelling in the nerve. Okay, we don't go without confirming the diagnosis radiologically. It's not a case for you. It's a 40 years old male sustained an inversion injury of his ankle while playing sand volleyball 2 weeks ago. Present today with persistent pain in lateral lower ankle. Diagnosed with ankle sprain, had normal x-ray. So had ecchymosis and pain inferior to the lateral malleolus. No longer has ecchymosis or swelling now because he came to the clinic after 2 weeks. Tenderness inferior to the lateral malleolus. Pain reproduced with resisted eversion of the foot. So when you do the ankle examination, you check all this movement with resistant. Put a resistant and ask the patient to move your foot against the resistance. So how the resisted movement help you in diagnosis?
Maybe fracture.
Huh?
Fracture.
Oh, what caused the eversion? Eversion of the foot. Which muscles cause the eversion of the foot?
Lateral tibia muscle.
Yeah, lateral. These lateral peronei. Peroneus brevis and brevis and longus. So if you want to check the integrity of these muscles, you put them on either integrity or an inflammation. You
resisted.
And when the patient feels pain, so it means there is either partial tear or inflammation of the tendon, tendinitis or partial tear. Okay. If patient cannot move at all eversion, it means a complete rupture. Okay. But you cannot differentiate between inflammation of the tendon and the partial tear. Okay. Then you have to investigate further. Because in both condition, the pain will be there. You cannot differentiate between an inflammation and a partial rupture. Yes.
What about the tenderness inferior to the lateral malleus?
Yeah, tenderness inferior to the lateral malleus. Yeah, tenderness in both condition, inflammation as well as the partial tear.
So thanks. So the tear in calcaneo tibia
over there. Before the below the, yeah, that can be. I mean, you can make a point. Yes. can be.
Like, too many information, doctor, to collect.
Yeah. Say it again.
Keep going.
Say it again.
What did you say, sir?
No, I say yes. You can say on clinical history. I can suspect maybe a tear of the calcaneofibular ligament, but pain last line, which I stressed on, pain reproduced with resisted eversion. That will not happen in the sprain of the calcaneofibular ligament. Agree or not agree?
Of course, doctor, clear.
Huh? Yeah, I say as you do the different tests, you differentiate here. I mean, you rightly said, yeah, why not it's even inversion G? Why not the calcaneofibular ligament? Okay, so but the thing is, resisted eversion should not be painful. Peroneal tendons, yeah, okay, this is the one. This is the peroneus brevis attached to the base of the fifth metatarsal, and this is your peroneus, what your longus. Okay, peroneus brevis go across the foot and insert onto the base of the, it goes all the way from the lateral side to the medial side and insert over the base of the first metatarsal. Peroneal tendon injury, examination, tenderness of peroneal tendons as they pass posterior to the lateral malleolus, pain with resisted eversion, pain with passive inversion. Why the patient feel pain with passive inversion if there is an injury to the peroneal tendon? Why?
We are stretching the...
Yes, exactly. You are stretching with passive. Resisted eversion, you are asking the peroneal tendon to work for pain. So passive inversion is you. But if the passive inversion, if you check the passive inversion against resistance and patient feels pain, what that signifies?
Other part of muscle.
Medial part, isn't it? The muscles which cause the inversion of the foot. So which muscles cause the inversion of the foot?
Right, doctor. We forget the anatomy.
Yeah, and basically your tibialis anterior and tibialis posterior. The two muscles, yes. They cause inversion.
They go medial, behind the medial.
And they go medial. One go behind the posterior malleolus, one goes in front of the medial malleolus, tibialis anterior. Right, okay, so imaging, ultrasound, management, ice, rest, non-steroidal, weeks to allow for rest, 2 to 4 weeks, tendon dislocation, subluxation may require operative management. And sometimes with these injuries, the tendons, they subluxate and you feel the clicking. When you invert the foot or inversion, you feel the tendons, they are moving out of their place. Then need a surgical treatment for that. Case 10 is not going to finish today, isn't it? So 24 years old female runner training for a marathon with 1 month of heel pain. Initially only had pain with running, now having pain with walking. Pain increases with weight bearing, tenderness over the medial lateral calcaneum. Medial side, medial to lateral calcaneum. Pain with calcaneal squeeze testing. So what is the diagnosis? So regular runner, female regular runner, young patient, 24 years old. Maybe older than you guys.
Maybe stress fracture.
Yes, that is the diagnosis really in a young person. Stress fracture of the calcaneum. Yeah. How do you diagnose? Pain with calcaneum. You want to confirm the diagnosis or no?
X-ray.
X-ray not show up?
Sometimes not appear on the X-ray.
Yeah.
Because it's very minor, very small.
Yeah. You're right. So you have to do the CT scan or, when they say it may be a fracture over there. This sclerosis over there may be healing. Start with radiograph, lateral and heel x-rays. If x is not normal, clinical suspicion remain, consider CT or MRI. Here you can see on the MRI, is MRI, isn't it? It's not the CT, isn't it?
Yes.
Is CT or MRI?
No, this is MRI.
Which section is that?
The sagittal, doctor.
That is it, mashallah. You people are good. When I was in fourth year, I was not even aware of sagittal and coronal. Bad student I was. So this is sagittal side. Yeah. So you always come across these sort of things. Sagittal cut, coronal cut, and what are the other cuts? In the CT and MRI, remember three cuts.
Central.
Yeah, axial cut. Axial cut. Which you go like that. Like that, up, axial cut. So if you go from the front, that is called the coronal cut. When you go from here to here, you understand what I'm trying to elicit? Cut from here to here, here, you go from front to the back, that is your coronal cut. If you go from side, here to backward, but this axial cut is when you go like that.
Sagittal gives us right and left part, coronal, anterior
and posterior. Anterior to posterior, exactly. An axial cut, anterior, posterior. I mean, they are circular. You see the bone circle as a circle. I don't know whether there is any picture of axial cut. So basically, you go from here, here, up cut, here, here, like cut, these cuts. From bottom to the top. This is from the front to the back is this one. And this is from medial to the lateral side, or lateral to medial side is sagittal cup. Front to the bottom is, there's a front, your anterior to the posterior is your coronal cut. And bottom to the bottom of the foot to the top of the, like this cut, these are axial cuts. Just remember these three. Stress fracture, reduction in activity. So you have to reduce the activity until the pain settles. If pain with walking may need to be non-weight bearing until pain-free with walking. Slow progression back into activity, again reducing impact if pain returns. Addition of heel cushions or orthotics if needed. Assessment of calcium and vitamin D status. So just to make sure the vitamin D level is okay. Full healing usually takes 2 to 3 months in stress fracture of the calcaneum. Posterior heel pain, Haglund syndrome, retrocalcaneal bursitis. I mean, in the heel, there are so many things. You have tendoachilles, you have bursas, okay, and you have this bony. Insidious onset of pain in posterior heel due to swelling of bursa between achilles and calcaneus. This is the achilles tendon. You can see the shadow of this one in a plain X-ray one. Attaches over to the back of the heel. Okay, there's a bursa between insertion of this and of this tendon and the bone. And a bursa behind that as well.
This is not the case before, right? This is a new case.
Yeah, new case. New case. Posterior heel pain. Okay. And the other one was calcaneal fracture. Yeah, this is a different one. Yeah. And due to swelling of bursa between achilles and calcaneus, better when barefoot or in open back shoes. Okay. So when you come across this sort of a pain, back of the heel, ask the patient not to wear any shoes which cause pressure over here. It's better to be a open shoes. Okay, associated with Haglund's deformity. Haglund deformity, when you see the calcification over here. Okay, sometimes you see a little view of the axis. Normally you don't see this. Normally the tendon attaches over here. Sometimes you see the calcification. This is anterior to the tendon or sometimes within it as well. Treatment, again, the painkiller, steroid, heel cord stretching and physiotherapy. Case 11, 35 years old woman sustained an inversion injury of her ankle while playing basketball. Came down on another player foot after jumping for a rebound. Diagnosed with ankle sprain, persistent pain in the anterior ankle after 6 weeks. So initially he was diagnosed as ankle sprain as because of an inversion injury. So intermittent ankle swelling, feels ankle catching and locking. So this patient initially treated as an ankle sprain, but the pain did not settle after 6 weeks and there was no instability, but the persistent pain in the anterior ankle, it was not on the lateral side. Okay, so what is the diagnosis? And when the ankle movement, feeling some catching and locking sensation. So what that means? Intermittent ankle swelling.
Maybe fractured.
Maybe fracture after 6 weeks, yeah. Intermittent ankle swelling means something going inside.
Inflammation.
Huh? Intermittent ankle swelling. Something was going to the ankle. Feels ankle catching. It means something inside the ankle joint. That signifies.
Maybe tendon between the bones or ligament.
Yeah. freeze ankle catching and locking.
Oh, nerves is the brain.
Something inside the ankle joint. Ankle swelling as well. Okay, what they say? Taylor osteochondral defects. Diagnosis was Taylor osteochondral. So this is a talus, this is a distal tibia, this is a medial malleolus, little leg. So this ankle sprains with associated compressive forces, long standing from a junk. So it was inversion injury, but with a longitudinal compression. Patient jumped from the height and inverted his foot. So there is a longitudinal compression. There is a force transmitted like plus the inversion. So this combined mechanism, not only simple inversion. Okay, inversion, the foot moved towards this side. There is a compressive load as well. Most commonly in the supromedial dome. So this is the dome of the talus. Most of the time you see it onto the hair. So you can see a really lucent area over here. Symptom examination, swelling, pain, catching and locking, as I explained earlier. Tenderness, talus, and not over ligament. Sometimes it's not easy to elicit this tenderness over here. Imaging X-ray may seen on mortise view. CT and MRI, they are conclusive. When treatment is non-operative and operative.
Doctor.
Depending on the grade of this osteochondral lesion. If the osteochondral lesion in a young person is in place, okay, you can treat with a plaster and it usually heals. But if there is a, you see a, I'll just tell you later on, I think next slide is there. Grade 1 articular cartilage injury only, conservative. Grade 2 articular cartilage injury with underlying fracture. It's grade 1, grade 2. If there's a line of fracture but it's in place, again, you can treat conservative. Okay. Grade 3, detached but not displaced. So you say, this is grade 3, detached but still in place, potentially surgical. Okay. In normally, if I see this osteochondral lesion with this one, we try to fix this. But if it's completely detached, displaced fragment, fragment with the cartilage displaced, then you really, it acts as a loose body. So if you diagnose early, you replace it over here and put a screw. Or if it's long-standing, you cannot, then you have to remove it as well, displaced fragment. So there are four grades. Grade 1, only articular injury, no bone involvement. Grade 2, crack there under the bone in place. So grade 1, 2, 3. 1, 2 is conservative. 3, 4, this is potentially surgical or not surgical. Right, and to fix it, okay. With the fear, it may displace later. If it's displaced, then it will be difficult surgery. So you can apply this osteochondral defects in any, normally you see a lot in the knee joint, osteochondral defect, osteochondritis dissecans, you call it over there. When these cases going to finish, this is 17 years old belly dancer presenting with increasing pain in her forefoot with dancing, no pain with walking, pain improved some with a week of rest, but returned when she started dancing again. Focal tendons over the second metatarsal. So diagnosis?
Stress fracture. There is scoliosis formation. There is scoliosis formation on the X-ray.
Yeah, this is stress fracture, okay. And diagnosis with an MRI or bone scan. This is a bone scan, increase uptake in the second. This is the big toe. Bone scan is good for the stress fracture or the MRI.
Doctor, this is a radioisotope, isn't it?
Yeah. When the MRI was not available, CT was not available, we used to do the bone scan. It's quite diagnostic of this increased activity, stress fracture, metatarsal stress fracture. Risk factors, high arches, repetitive impact activity, running, marching, dancing. So again, non-weight bearing with crutches if pain with walking. Slow return to normal activity when pain-free with walking and to palpation over the stress injury. May need orthosis to help prevent future injury, some sort of a foot and sore. So differential diagnosis of heel pain, calcaneus stress fracture, traumatic fracture, plantar fasciitis, fat pad atrophy. It's, I don't know why this is atrophy. I mean, you have the heel pad between the calcaneum and if they got atrophy, they can cause some pain. I never come across this diagnosis. Achilles tendinopathy, which is on the back. Achilles bursitis, Haglund deformity, again is on the back. Okay. In tendinopathy, you may not see much of the swelling, but Achilles bursitis, you always see a swelling on the back. You always see as a bump onto the back of the heel. Differential diagram, ankle pain, ankle sprain, syndesmotic injury, fifth metatarsal fracture, navicular fracture, peroneal tendon injury, fracture, fibula, tibula, tenus, calcaneus, any other bone, Achilles tendon injury. Posterior heel sprain, there's one more, Severs disease. You will see in a young children between 9 to 14 years, they complain mostly bilateral pain, heel pain, and with activity. And when you take the X-ray, you always see increased sclerosis of the epiphysis. If you see, is more whitening over here. Can you appreciate that or no? Hello?
Yeah.
You see whitening. Sometimes you see fragmentation of that.
Yeah.
On the epiphysis. So this is called Severs disease. Okay, and usually the treatment is conservative. You ask the child to restrict your activity so that you know, once they stop growing, the pain usually goes away as well. Thanks, Rob.
Thank you.
So what did you retain and what you did not retain?
Say, doctor, the treatment is...
Say it again. Is too much or less?
Treatment is... doctor, I think too much.
Huh? Too much?
Too much, doctor.
I think too much.
Yeah, this is what I feel, really.
Doctor, too so much.
Too so much, yeah. I don't know how to minimize that.
Three so much.
And what about the osteoarthritis of the knee? That was too much as well?
No, that lecture was very good.
I see. So you prefer to be one topic and concentrate on that instead of...
Yes, it's much better than like this case, 10 cases, 10 different pathology, 10 uh-huh. different signs and treatment.
Yeah.
We can't absorb these kind of questions.
I agree with you. Yes, I don't know. Really. Anyway, we'll discuss with tutor and just inshallah, I should be.
But your explanation is very good, doctor. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor, for your explanation.
Okay. Thank you, Vajay. So have a nice holiday. So when you'll be back? After 2 weeks?
Inshallah, after 2 weeks.
I see. It's okay.
Inshallah.
It's okay. Have a nice new year.
Thank you.
Enjoy your holidays with your family.
Happy Christmas.
Okay. Then. Assalamu alaikum.
No Christmas.
Shad al-Khawib Christmas.
Christmas all in one end.
No, no, Christmas gone. Christmas no more.
Christmas is gone.